My ancestors, to my shock and great upset, were the largest slave trading family in U.S. history.
Boy, and we figured if anybody was going to be late.
I tracked down 200 DeWolf descendants from all over the country and contacted them about coming on this trip. 9 people signed up. We range from siblings to 7th cousins. Many of us are actually meeting for the first time. DeWolfs have been going to St. Michael's Church for over 250 years. They wanted us to come here, too. The church was pretty much new to me, because I grew up in Philadelphia, where I was steeped in America's democratic ideals. In Bristol, it seems like the DeWolfs were the founding fathers. They were everywhere in the church. They even paid for the stained glass. My mind was swirling with all kinds of questions. What would we have to face on this trip? How would we have to rethink our sense of home and who we are today? But more importantly, what could we do as DeWolf descendants to help repair the enormous harm that our ancestors caused?
I didn't know this. I didn't know growing up. I didn't know that they were the largest slave trading family in U.S. history. I found that out thanks to the work of a scholar who wrote a book in the 1980s about the slave trade from Rhode Island. I found out from my grandmother in my late 20s about this. But no sooner had I found out than I realized that I already knew and had repressed it. So I don't know when I first found out, but I probably first found out maybe as a teenager. But it was spoken of very offhandedly in my family, very as if boys will be boys, or as if it was just some pirate story. So it was never taken seriously and talked about seriously in my family. But no one actually knew the vast extent of their involvement until I found this book by a historian about it. So as most Americans listening to this know, we aren't educated to, we're educated to assume that the South was solely responsible for slavery and that the North were the abolitionists and the heroes that ended slavery. So the more I dug into it, the more I found out that the North had basically won the Civil War and written the history books in our favor. So Northern complicity in slavery, as I came to found out, was massive. The North were the leading slave traders, sending the ships to Africa. The North took raw materials from the South and from the islands, so sugar and cotton, coffee, etc., and we were the ones who processed that in our factories. So there's been a major disconnect and this assumption that it really was a Southern sin. And the film is a process of both telling the truth about Northern complicity and then also showing my family, 10 of us, retracing the triangle trade, trying to come to terms with what does this mean for us today? How does it help explain our status and our access and our sense of entitlement and our privileges? And even though we're all, you know, today, the family members that came on the journey, you know, are sort of emblematic of good liberal white people who have very good intentions and are not trying to do any harm, it's really important to understand how we have a head start or a leg up in terms of our lives in America today. Well, I don't want to not give credit to a great uncle who wrote a book in the 1950s in which he had a chapter about the slave trade. So he didn't know the extent of it. So, you know, the fact that they were the worst of the worst has not been known in the family. But when both the role of my family and the role of the North became more clear to those of us who undertook this journey, and then became clear to over a million people when the film aired on television, I'll speak more broadly first, which is, if you assign responsibility for slavery to just the South, then you can just very unconsciously assume that it is just the South's problem to deal with the legacy of slavery, and you invent categories like evil racists, and we have stereotypes to this day. Like when you hear, you know, when you hear a white Southern accent, many Northerners, without even realizing it, have a negative association with white Southern accents. So when the truth hits and you realize that the whole nation, and I could go into more details, but the Midwest was also complicit, and Western states were producing agriculture that fed slaves. So when you see how vast it was, I basically felt like my whole head was getting reoriented. You know, it's sort of like, okay. And there was actually a scholar I met with early on who said, you know, Katrina, when you make this film, you're going to hear from a lot of white descendants of immigrants who came, you know, Italian and Polish and Irish, you know, who came to the United States either at the tail end of slavery or after slavery, and they're going to tell you it's not their problem because they weren't here then and because they were poor. And he said, but what you tell them, this is what you tell them when they say that. He said, you know, it was a booming economy, and that's what attracted the immigrants. It was the land of opportunity. You know, the streets were paved with gold. So people were flocking to the United States because of the economic opportunity, and that was because it was a thriving economy built on unpaid labor. And again, that was just this big, like, the wheels in my head had to completely reorient to realize how intertwined slavery was with the Industrial Revolution, with capitalism. So there was a very personal process in my family, but then the film resonates with people much more broadly because it kind of sheds light on a very buried... it changes the story of how we understand slavery when you face the truth, and when the story changes, you have to kind of reframe many things about today. Mm-hmm. Today's an interesting time, and Ferguson is a powerful example, because you have, as opposed to, say, 50 years ago, so we're facing a lot of the 50th anniversaries of civil rights landmarks right now, of desegregation and the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act. So 50 years ago, the struggle was to change the laws and to end, you know, to live up to some of the promises that had been made 100 years earlier in the 1860s at the end of slavery. So finally the laws were brought up to where they should have been in terms of equality, and there was affirmative action. So everything was focused on sort of structural access and law. So you have a moment like today, 50 years later, where the vast majority of white Americans self-identify as not racist and think of themselves as colorblind and as not prejudiced. And so then when you have the persistence of poverty and other, you know, social deprivations in low-income Black communities, so not for all Black Americans, but in low-income Black communities, there aren't many white people. There are probably many white people who, like, feel bad and are wringing their hands and, oh, that's so terrible, but they don't really think of it as their problem, and they don't think of it as... they don't think of it as the product of racism, because they think there isn't any more racism. But the problem is that the impacts of the disparities that still exist are huge. So the disparities, when you look at all the statistics of health, social indicators, health, education, housing, wealth, you know, economic prosperity, all of that, you have these huge disparities. And so I think the challenge today is to figure out how to inspire more white Americans to consider those disparities to be their problem, and without having to feel guilty. So I think human psychology-wise, like humans, we don't like to feel shame. We don't like to feel guilt. we don't like people to think we're bad. And so I think a lot of white people avoid working on issues of racial inequality because they think that that must mean admitting that they're bad. So I try to talk about this in all my public speaking because I went into all of this feeling extremely bad, extremely guilty because of my ancestors. And through the process of doing this, have become, I think I have a healthier relationship to a sense of responsibility that's just like, I'm a citizen in this country. I have huge privileges that came from this. My family is not super wealthy. So I'm, you know, people can assume that, you know, I've had riches still from then, but no, but we did well in subsequent generations. But in any case, so cases like Ferguson is an example of the legacy of housing segregation and the legacy of, you know, the way tax bases in cities are. So you have like very structural problems of how the economies of cities work and who has the better schools. And then when you add on top of that a sense of alienation where white and black Americans, you know, even if white Americans say they're not racist, it's really hard to find white people who have really, really, really close friends who are African American. You just don't see a kind of, you know, interweaving of neighborhoods and families and friendship. So there's a fundamental level of sort of alienation and separateness that's still very much part of the problem. I could go on. Well, there's a thing that happens when I and other people do public speaking about, for example, implicit or unconscious bias. So I think white people in the US and perhaps in Europe carry a lot of nervousness and anxiety about being politically correct and about, you know, trying not to be racist. And we don't realize that you can be consciously not racist, but you can be unconsciously racist and prejudiced. And when you tell people about how the brain works, they relax and they go, oh, okay. So I see hope in the fact, I mean, this may sound odd, but I see hope in what the field of neuroscience is telling us about how the brain works. And suddenly you don't feel like an evil person when you realize that, stereotypes that are, you would think would be gone are still there because of the way our minds get programmed from a very young age. So black men are still distrusted and feared in the United States, very deeply so by most white people. And when you kind of break through to the other side of that and you develop relationships with black men and you realize, oh my God, what a huge stereotype you've been carrying. And then neuroscience tells you, it's okay, like you got programmed, you know, you got programmed. And your amygdala back here, your reptilian brain, you know, the way fight and flight kicks in and things like that, you see how we're wired, and then you don't feel as alienated from the person because you go, oh, us crazy humans, you know.
What do you wish for, having all these, I mean, you've been really digging through a lot, mm-hmm. And discovered a lot, mm-hmm. both about humanities and your own family and society. What do you wish for?
I wish that schools would put a much, 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 much bigger emphasis than they do on teaching history and sort of all sorts of things. I mean, you can use literature and history and the arts and, you know, classes on citizenship and on multicultural society, using all of those as a chance for kids to get skilled in all of this at a much younger age, that will create such healthier societies. So I've been looking very specifically at how do schools teach about slavery, And most teachers are scared to teach about slavery, and they skip over it as quickly as they can. And yet, what are the kids learning when they hear about the enslavement of Africans? If you're black, how do you feel as a kid? If you're white, how do you feel as a kid? So it's just an example of one moment that if teachers were trained and did enough of their own work inside themselves, that they could help kids just get into the painfulness of it. They could learn the painfulness and the hope messages, like to really, you know, there's a lot to it, more than I can say, but at the moment, but to sort of help them think existentially about how these things came to be in colonialism and slavery, and how to get to a place of forgiveness, even, you know, if you're working on things like that at a young age, that's really good news for the future. Mm-hmm.